Hey, it's Tim back for Wrong Sports, and on this channel, I like to cover the good, but mostly the bad of college football, as I have done countdowns as well as deep dives on different subjects, not just in college football, but all over college sports. Even though I do cover other sports, I mostly and will continue to cover college football, and in this new series, I'll be covering college football teams that are no longer with us, or at least not in their original form. Now, I say not in the same form or in their original form because some of these teams that I'll be covering are playing now but have dropped to a much lower division and aren't the same team as they used to be. But I really wanted to do this new series because even though these teams are gone, or at least in a diminished form, they still have tons of really cool and interesting history. That is what I'm going to be covering here. And the first team that I'll be covering is the NYU Violets football team. Now, I'm choosing them first because I am from New Jersey. I'm actually from the tri-state area, and I've always heard about their great teams. Also, I wanted to cover them because they were one of the first intercollegiate teams as they started playing in 1873 and played a lot of great Eastern schools as well as schools from all over the country. Plus, to go along with that, they would have two very significant players, one who was known for his record-setting talent and another who was more well-known for his modeling of a college football treasure. But before I go through the history and the ups and downs of NYU, make sure you subscribe to the channel and ring the bell as well, because that will give you a heads up on when I'm going to be dropping new videos, because I'm trying to drop them every other week, or like I'm doing right now. I'm going to be doing two videos in a row and then probably taking 2 weeks off, and then I'll be back with a few more videos again. So make sure you ring the bell right there. That'll give you a heads up on when I'm dropping my next video. Plus, make sure you like this video and make sure you share this video and leave me a comment at the bottom and tell me what other teams you want me to cover in this series. But the first intercollegiate football game was in 1869 between Princeton and Rutgers, and in the ensuing years, other schools in New Jersey and New York would start to join in. By 1873, NYU would get in on playing as they were the second NYC school behind Columbia to start playing. Even though they were both in NYC, NYU wouldn't really play Columbia, or really any other schools besides Stevens Tech, which is now known as Stevens Institute of Technology, and it's located in Hoboken, New Jersey, and they would play that school for the first few seasons. From 1873 to 1876, they only played Stevens, and they lost to them in all those years, not scoring a point. They didn't schedule many games, and I really couldn't find many records on them until 1897, when it looked like they scheduled more than three games that season against more than just Stevens Tech. Another thing I saw was that NYU didn't win a game until 1897, when they defeated Stevens two times and Bard College. But during the year, NYU did play Lehigh for the first time, and they were a team that they would play throughout their run. NYU would hire their first coach in 1898. His name was Frank H. Kahn, and he was really NYU's director of Department of Physical Training and Athletics, so he was already on campus. So it really wasn't more of a hiring as much of a, hey, why don't you go coach that football team over there? Kahn would only last one season. He went 1-3 that season, and they would continue to go through coaches every year, never being better than 5-3, which they were in 1902. Their fortunes would change, though, when they hired Herman Alcott in 1907. Alcott was an All-American in 1900 at Yale, and he was 11-4-3 in his two seasons at University of North Carolina in 1902 and 1903. He came to NYU and made them better with a 5-2 record in 1907. Then he got them to an unbeaten 6-0-1 record in 1909. They tied Lehigh, but they beat smaller colleges like Haverford, Wesleyan, and Union, with their big win being over Rutgers and that tie versus Lehigh. Also that season, they had 5 shutouts with only giving up 18 points, so 1909 was their real first great year, and because of that, it would bring big changes to their schedule as they would start playing bigger and better teams in the 1910s. Now, the 1910s weren't all that bad, as they had Alcott coaching them to start the decade. He would be helpful, as he had knowledge of the more elite schools that would come on their schedule, like Princeton and Alcott's alma mater, Yale. The 1910 season started with a big one versus Princeton on the road, and they got to see what an elite team was because they got shut out in the game 12-0. The rest of their season had them only beat Stevens and Rutgers, but they would play the undefeated and unscored on Navy squad, and guess what happened to them? Yeah, they lost and got shut out. NYU was 2-4-1 this season. NYU played both Princeton and Navy again on the road in 1912, with the same shutout scores happening and resulting in another 2-win season. With Alcott not being able to reach the heights he had at the beginning of his tenure, he would leave, resulting in them having a pretty bad 1912. 2012-13 season. And with Alcott leaving, it resulted in NYU going 0-8 in 1913, and to make matters worse, they didn't even score a point. The rest of the decade didn't really go better for them, but it went better than 1913. They were still changing coaches every year, and only having above 500 records in 1914 and 1916. They weren't able to play the likes of Princeton and Navy either, but they did play NYC foe Columbia, and they went 3-2 during the 1914 through 1919 seasons. But I went over Columbia football history in my deep dive of Columbia, so yeah, you might know how they don't really have the greatest football team either. Their fortunes didn't look that great when the 1920s started, as they had consecutive two-win seasons before they got a change in coach. The coach that came in was Tom Thorpe, who was named to Walter Camp's All-American team as a player at Columbia before he coached at Fordham in 1912 and 1913. Thorpe took a break from coaching as the war went on before he came to NYU in 1922. Thorpe whipped the team into shape quickly as they had a preseason camp at Fort Sulkum on Long Island before playing a scrimmage against the team from the military base. That preseason really helped them as they won four games that season. And this led them to having their best season in a decade or so, as they went 6-2 in 1923, beating NYC teams CCNY and Fordham, and the Fordham win was significant as they played at Yankee Stadium, and this had become a yearly tradition for the rest of this rivalry. Thorpe would leave after the 1924 season, and NYU would welcome a new coach and a fellow New Yorker in Chick Meehan. Meehan was a quarterback at Syracuse in the mid-1910s, then became the coach of Syracuse in 1920. He was really good at Syracuse too. Over his five seasons, he went 35-8-4, plus he coached Syracuse to a win over NYU during that time too. Coach Meehan would come in with a winner's mentality, and it showed in his first season in 1925, when NYU started 5-0. Unfortunately, they faltered at the end to a 6-2-1 finish, but it was a great season that brought great fan support from all over the city. In 1926, they would start even better, going 8-0 and beating teams like Rutgers, Tulane, Fordham, and Carnegie Tech. In addition, all of those wins happened at Yankee Stadium. And the Carnegie Tech win was pretty significant this year, because Tech would beat Notre Dame and ruin Notre Dame's perfect season, so the win looked really good for NYU towards the end of the season. There weren't polling rankings during the season or more than one bowl game, as the Rose Bowl did exist. But it was too bad, because NYU could have been in both at this time. NYU would settle for a season finale road game in Lincoln, Nebraska, a week before Thanksgiving. The game was ugly, as it was during a snowstorm. There were tons of fumbles, missed field goals, and extra points, and this resulted in a 15-7 loss, wrecking NYU's perfect season. Even though that season ended in a heartbreaker, NYU really started to show who they were during that season, and that was a graceful rushing attack. In 1927, they had Frank Briante, who averaged over 130 scrimmage yards per game, and he would break Red Grange's record that was set only a few years earlier. He would end the season with over 1,400 scrimmage yards and at least 10 touchdowns for NYU. NYU once again started their season undefeated as they beat Rutgers and Fordham at Yankee Stadium to be 5-0. They would tie Colgate and Penn State and manhandle Allegheny and Carnegie Tech to be 7-0-2 in 1927. But once again, they ended their season traveling to Nebraska on Thanksgiving weekend, and once again, they would lose 27-18 to end their season 7-1-2. Another unbeaten year ruined, but next year was one of their more famous years because of another famous player. So when the 1928 season started, they didn't have Briante carrying the ball anymore, so they would elevate Ken Strong to the role. Strong did some running in 1927, but it was mostly kicking extra points and other kicking. This year, though, he would run the ball as well as do some kicking, and it would show in Game 1, as they would play Niagara, and Ken Strong would score all of NYU's points, as he would score 3 touchdowns and kick 3 extra points in their 21-0 win. So it was already starting pretty well for him. And NYU didn't have a lot of trouble in Game 2, but Strong would only score 1 touchdown and 2 extra points in a 26-7 win over West Virginia Wesleyan. They would play NYC foe Fordham in a different NYC venue next, as they played this year in the Polo Grounds. And in this game, Kent Strong ran for 2 TD runs, one of 55 yards, plus he kicked four extra points and threw for a 36-yard touchdown pass and NYU's 34-7 win. They played their next three games in Yankee Stadium and Strong showed off with four touchdowns, including one of an 89-yard dash, added five extra points, along with passing for 170 yards and two touchdowns in a 48-0 win over Rutgers. Then, in a 47-6 win over Colgate, Strong ran for two touchdowns, got a 75-yard interception return for a touchdown, and added five more extra points and also threw for two touchdown passes. So Strong, by this point, had 95 points through five games, and not only was NYC talking about him, but the whole country was talking about him. Their next game, though, ruined their dream season, as defense and weather was an issue as the rain fell in Yankee Stadium as they would play Georgetown. 50,000 people showed up to see Strong, but they didn't see Kent Strong really do anything. He didn't run, pass, or kick, as NYU only got a safety in a 7-2 loss. NYU would rebound with big wins over Alford, winning 71-0. Plus, they would beat Missouri in Yankee Stadium, as Strong ran and also threw for a touchdown. Plus, he kicked three extra points in a 27-6 win. Strong's All-American performance, though, came versus Carnegie Tech. It was NYU's only game outside of New York City, and Strong ended up with 26 carries for 223 yards. Oh, plus, he also passed 8 of 15 passes for 108 yards and one touchdown, and he also kicked a couple of extra points. And they won this game 27-13, pretty much all on the back of Strong. The win was bigger because Carnegie Tech was undefeated coming in, and they just beat Notre Dame the previous week. NYU would have one more game in Yankee Stadium versus Oregon State, and Strong would throw, run, and kick, and even return kicks. But even with over 200 scrimmage yards, NYU fell 25-13, so NYU ended their season 8-2. But this was really their strongest season, as they would play teams from all over the country. They drew 40,000 or more spectators in four games, and Ken Strong would have over 2,000 scrimmage yards. And some record books would have him at over 3,000. Now, that might be counting returning yards as well, but I really couldn't find all the return yards for all these games, so I'm just going to put him at over 2,000 scrimmage yards, which seems crazy enough. Strong led the nation with scoring 162 points, which was more than half of his team's total for this year. Chick Meehan would coach three more years as they would finish with back-to-back 7-3 records and a 6-3-1 1931 season to end his run. During these 3 years, they would play teams from all over the country as they would play University of Georgia, Oregon, Missouri, and Tennessee, only beating Georgia once in 1929, and they beat Missouri in 1930. For 1932 and 1933, they were coached by Howard Kahn. He was the NYU basketball coach at the time, and he was also the son of NYU's first coach, Frank Kahn. Howard would have a better run than his father would, but that was only because they went 5-3 in 1932. They dropped to two wins in 1933, and that would bring in a new coach in Mal Stevens. Stevens was coming off several years of coaching at Yale. He would go through a three-win season as well as an injury-plagued season in 1934 to start his run here at NYU. But then he turned it all around in 1935 as NYU started 7-0. They beat Georgetown, Rutgers, Carnegie Tech, and CCNY, as well as scoring over 30 points in four of those wins. In their final game, they played Fordham at Yankee Stadium in front of their biggest audience yet, 72,000 people. Fordham's coming into their game with their legendary 7 blocks of granite line, and they were 5-1-2 on the year. So this game was just for bragging rights, as they didn't have a chance of getting to a bowl game with that one loss. That was the opposite, though, for NYU, as they had a chance to go to the Rose Bowl with this win. But unfortunately, NYU was outclassed all game, and Fordham beat them and shut them out 21-0. This game was a huge loss for NYU, and the people in attendance knew it, as there were several fights in the stands and on the field. Even though NYU might have gotten their Rose Bowl invite taken away with that loss, they do have some other big history this year, and it comes from a player. The player was the running back, Ed Smith. He was out of Washington Heights in New York City, and he was a triple threat as he could run, pass, and kick. He was one of NYU's best players in 1933. He would get injured in 1934 before playing and really being their best player in that 1935 season. I didn't find tons of stats on him, but he does show up in several game stories, mostly for his passing game. However, during the 1935 season, a high school classmate of his, Frank Eliscu, ask him to pose for a trophy he was trying to create. Ed Smith posed with one leg up and a strong stiff arm. And Eliscu, who was only 20 at the time, would create the most famous trophy in all of college football and one of the most famous in all of sports, the Heisman Trophy. Ed Smith would never win a Heisman Trophy, but he pretty much got the best gift of all, as he was the model for it. He was gifted one, though, on the 50th anniversary in 1985. But Coach Stevens and NYU got back at Fordham in 1936. They would struggle to a 4-3-1 record that season, including a 61-0 opening season loss to Ohio State. But NYU would end their season with a huge 7-6 win over Fordham. It ruined Fordham's unbeaten season and also ruined Fordham's shot at going to a Rose Bowl. This also gave NYU their first ever win over a ranked team, so it was one of their biggest games ever. After that upset win over Fordham, NYU didn't really have the best luck for the rest of the 1930s, but this was still their best decade. They would end the 1930s with their best record being 5-4 in 1937 and 5-4 in 1939. But in 1939, they were ranked for the first time in the AP poll after they beat undefeated and ranked Carnegie Tech. To end this decade, they lost to NYC rival Fordham 18-7 in Yankee Stadium, and that loss would be a telling end to this decade and would also show the future for the NYU football team. Now, the fans might not have seen it yet in the 1930s, but the wheels were starting to fall off the program. It was more behind the scenes at the school, as they were struggling with money and admission during the Great Depression, and also because NYU is a highly selective university. But all of that behind the scenes didn't really come out until the 1940 season, as they struggled through it, winning only 2 games over smaller schools. And you could see the talent disparity as they played 3 ranked teams in 1930, and they were shut out in all of them, including an embarrassing way to end their season, getting shut out to Fordham in Yankee Stadium. They would also get shut out in another game versus Missouri. It was played in Columbia, Missouri too, and that was significant because there was a gentleman's agreement pushed by Missouri to not play any African-American players when playing in Missouri. NYU really didn't have a problem with that before because they did play him a couple of years ago as they didn't have any African-American players. But NYU would comply this time, but it would be a little different because they left behind their fullback, Leonard Bates. He was African-American, and he was also a pretty well-known starter for the team. When the students found out that NYU was going to comply with this racist agreement, even though Missouri traveled to NYC to play NYU in 1939, and also played them again the next season, and actually played Bates on the field, students went to Missouri to protest this stupid agreement. Apparently 2,000 students showed up to protest before the game, but it was dispersed quickly and mostly swept under the rug by both schools, as it really didn't come out for decades later. A handful of students that set up the protest were suspended by NYU, and this story of the suspended students came out decades later when NYU apologized to these students, honored them, and accepted blame for leaving Leonard Bates off the team for that game. But even though the school would apologize to the students and to Bates decades later, all of this, and just trying to sweep it away, started to show me that the people running NYU weren't really looking to run a football team anymore. Well, that wasn't the greatest way to end 1940, and the fans were looking for something different in 1941. But what they got was pretty much a rerun of 1940, but much worse. They started with a 2-game winning streak before a 7-game losing streak, where they were shut out in 5 games, and 5 games in a row, by the way, only scoring 16 points during the 7-game losing streak. And they would end their season with an embarrassing loss to 6-1 Fordham, who had accepted a bid to the Sugar Bowl earlier in the day. They would lose to them 30-9. This season was also Mal Stevens' last for NYU. He ended his NYU career going 33-34-2, but he helped to keep NYU an upper echelon team in the East and in New York, even though the athletic budget was dwindling and the school was looking for a way out. So even though Mal Stevens may have stepped down, NYU probably would have put his $10,000 a year job on ice anyway, since the country was at war at this time, and college men were going off to war, but also NYU was going through some budget concerns too. According to a Time magazine article, which was from March 9, 1942, it quoted then-Chancellor Harry Woodburn Chase. He said, "For the past 2 years, football has been conducted at a considerable deficit, and the university cannot retain this sport any longer. And that was the announcement that NYU's football program was done. The announcement wasn't a big deal since, you know, there was a world war going on. But then only 2 years later, the war was going much better for America, and students on campus were starting to itch for another football team. NYU obliged to the students, but there were going to be some big changes since the school was still running at a deficit, and they didn't want to spend a lot of money since war was still going on and no one knew of the exact economic future. NYU would take the same quiet approach as they did 4 years earlier when they suspended students, and they would start to quickly downgrade their football program from where they once were a decade earlier. First example being, they would start to quickly dwindle down games at Yankee Stadium, as they would only play 5 games there the rest of the decade. They did play at the Polo Grounds, but only a few times, and after the war, the stadium started to get inadequate anyway. Another change was that Stevens wasn't back at coach, as he was still in the Marine Corps, and he would later coach the pros after the war. So their new coach was a former player from the 1919 through 1921 teams, and he was also an assistant from time to time. His name was John Weinheimer. Clearly, they were looking for someone already on campus since, again, this was during the war, and Weinheimer was an assistant for the football team for the last 10 years or so. Also, they would no longer play bigger national schools and rarely traveled past Boston for the next couple of years, especially during the war when there was really no traveling whatsoever. Weinheimer would only win 5 games during the last 2 years of World War II, that being 1944 and 1945. Their biggest NYC foe, Fordham, didn't even play until 1946, so they didn't play them during these 2 years. But NYU didn't even schedule Princeton or Syracuse during this time, and it probably would have been good since both of those teams had losing records these years, and it probably would have been their best shot to get a win versus one of these two teams. But anyway, the war was over and the 1946 season started with NYU announcing that they would be playing again at Yankee Stadium with 2 games. And they would start well this season with a 4-2 record with all wins over smaller Eastern schools. But those losses were pretty bad, and one of them especially bad as they were embarrassed by Boston College, 72-6. But back to those final Yankee Stadium games. First, they played Fordham, who, like NYU, were not the same team they were before the war, as they were winless this year. But it still took them a last-minute score for NYU to beat Fordham for NYU's 5th win. NYU would lose their finale to Georgetown to be 5-3 to have their first winning record of the 1940s. And Weinheimer would leave on a high note as he didn't come back for the 1947 season, and NYU would hire Lafayette coach Edward Milan. Milan knew NYU well as Lafayette played NYU often before the war, and also he would beat NYU too. Milan was coming in looking to turn NYU's fortune around, and in 1947 it wasn't looking good as they went 2-5-1 and would also play more games on the road as less and less people were coming to their home games. And the school also wasn't scheduling many home games anyway. Example being their 2 home games at Yankee Stadium drew 13,000 people total over the 2 games, resulting in NYU losing to West Virginia 40-0, but they did beat Cornell, but that was in front of less than 6,000 fans. And at Yankee Stadium, less than 6,000 fans looks like nobody. Their final game was very telling of how downhill this team has gotten, as they tied 1-1 Fordham in front of 27,000 people in the Polo Grounds. But the game was significant as Fordham freshman coach and top assistant to the head coach was Vince Lombardi. Lombardi would remember the big games versus NYU in the 1930s, and it appears he coached to the best of his abilities, as they would score 13 points in this NYU game to tie NYU. And this was their top scoring output of the year, and this tie didn't look very good to NYU, since they were supposed to be a lot better than a 1-win Fordham team. And the home games would continue to dwindle. In 1948, NYU would only play 1 game at home, as they played Rutgers at Yankee Stadium in front of 4,000 people, and they got shut out 40-0. They would also play Fordham at the Polo Grounds, but they were designated the away team, and they lost and got shut out again in front of 26,000 people. They lost 20-0. The rest of the schedule had NYU traveling no further north than Boston to play Boston University, and they traveled no further south than DC to play Georgetown and Ithaca to play Cornell. All these resulted in losses and a 3-6 season in 1948. The 1949 season saw NYU's football program get even smaller as the school was supplying less of the football and sports program in general. And after World War II and American college football, if you wanted to be a top-notch college football program, you needed to care about your team. You also needed to have a place for them to play and the money for it. And NYU didn't have any of that for their team, as they didn't even play at home anymore, as they either played on the road or at a neutral site. In addition, they weren't even playing teams from all over the country like they were at the end of the 1930s, and instead playing schools within a four-hour bus ride, and that were much smaller than NYU. Milan would leave after the 1949 season, seeing that NYU wasn't going to be a top-notch program anymore, and also, he saw that the school really didn't care about him anymore. He wouldn't tell the next coach, though, who didn't notice that until he was hired already. And that new coach was a former Notre Dame coach. He was coming off four good years coaching at St. Bonaventure, and this coach also knew all about how good NYU used to be in the 1930s because he was an assistant on Fordham. That new coach was Hugh DeVore. DeVore came in looking to make over NYU into the powerhouse again, but as soon as he started, he saw that NYU really didn't have a budget anymore, and if he wanted one, he was going to have to supply it himself. The 1950 season started well with a win over Brooklyn College, but then they tied the Merchant Marines, who, like I said, they always beat, so maybe this was a sight of bad things to come. NYU would now travel to Rutgers, UConn, Bucknell, and Boston University, and they would lose all four of these games, giving up a total of 138 points, and they would only score four touchdowns. They would come back to the Polo Grounds and end the season versus the much-improved 6-1 Fordham Rams, who needed the 1946 through 49 seasons to finally get good again. Fordham shut out NYU 13-0 and gave NYU a 1-5-1 record. But what was more telling of the downfall of NYU and this rivalry was that 1,500 people showed up to the Polo Grounds to watch it, which looks like absolutely nobody there. So after not playing any home games, and I put quotations around home games, they would schedule two home games this year, except they weren't where they played before, as they scheduled two games at Triborough Stadium at Randall's Island, which is on a completely different island than where the school is. They started the season versus Princeton, and they would score 20 points in this game, but Princeton, with Heisman winner Dick Kazmaier, would run all over them, beating them 54-20. NYU followed that up with a win over Merchant Marines before playing their first home game versus Rutgers. 6,000 people would show up to Randall's Island to watch Rutgers absolutely destroy NYU, 55-0, and it didn't get any better for them the rest of their schedule, as their closest game was a 7-point loss to Lehigh. Otherwise, NYU lost and lost badly in their remaining games. Their final game and home game at Randall's Island versus Fordham had an attendance of 12,000 people, the biggest they had in a few years, but it didn't help NYU as they lost 41-0. They ended the 1951 season 1-7, and even though they drew 18,000 fans to their home games, the two of them, the fan support was dwindling, and the school support was non-existent. After 1951, Coach Hugh DeVore knew that the only way he could drum up more fan support and to actually save this team was to actually win, since in New York, the only way people really care about you is if you win. The 1952 season started that way with a home game on their new home field on Randall's Island. 5,000 people would show up this time to see NYU go on an 81-yard drive and kick a game-winning field goal to win with 17 seconds left over Lehigh and start their season 1-0. This was the first time they started with a win, so everyone was getting ready for some more winning. The winning was looking like it would continue as they faced Merchant Marines. NYU would storm out to a 14-0 lead, but the Merchant Marines would score three straight times to take a 20-14 lead. NYU would come back and score, but hooked the extra point, and they tied this game 20-20. NYU should have won this game, not only due to the missed kick, but they had at least four fumbles, and again, they never lost to Merchant Marines. They were still unbeaten as they would come home to play Holy Cross, who were 2-0 and coached by College Football Hall of Famer Eddie Anderson. Holy Cross would stay unbeaten as they would easily shut out NYU. NYU now 1-1-1. I love that record. They would be embarrassed in their next game as they traveled to Philly to play Temple before going a little farther north in Pennsylvania to play Lafayette. NYU had to come back in this game as Lafayette scored in the final quarter before NYU scored late in the third quarter. NYU would hold off Lafayette for the rest of the second half and scored late in the fourth quarter to take a 14-7 lead and win their second game. NYU got their second win, but they really should have won this game a whole lot easier because they ran all over the places. They had 300 yards in this game. They only gave up one passing yard, and Lafayette had under 100 yards total. NYU slogged on to Boston to lose a close one to BU. Then they would go to New Jersey to play Rutgers in a muddy condition game. NYU had a 14-7 lead on a Bob Moot interception return for a touchdown. Now remember that because it's important. And they were outscored 20-0 in the second half to lose again to Rutgers. Now they had one last game versus Fordham. It was at home on Randall's Island, and it was one of their most attended games, as 10,000 people showed up this time. But they didn't see a good game though, as Fordham ran them down, scoring at least a touchdown in every quarter to win 45-0. The game might have ended their season on a downer, but the close scores to start the season and the two wins got some people excited to see how the team would improve in 1953. But that didn't happen, as in early 1953, the football program was discontinued indefinitely, as the NYU chancellor at the time finally killed off the team due to a reported $100,000 deficit on the program that year. So it appears that the deficit from more than a decade earlier was still hounding the program. But after going over the final nine seasons of the football program, they really had no chance of making any money since they didn't play at home. There would be several attempts to bring back the program over the ensuing years, but to no avail. There are several reasons for this program going away. The biggest reason was that the school didn't have the money or the time to worry about athletics. This showed as the school agreed with the gentleman's agreement with Missouri and didn't bring their black athletes to Missouri, basically just throwing up their hands at this racist and non-legal agreement. Then there were all those protests that just got swept under the rug, and it just seemed like all that stank got all over the football program, at least locally, because it showed in fans' attendance at the game. It would be noticeable in 1941 as it was going down to just barely 10,000 people a game in their Yankee Stadium games, and they had their smallest attended game versus Fordham that year too. Another downfall that ties into that last thing is that NYU never really had a home stadium, as their football stadium, Ohio Field, was built in the 1890s and it needed to be upgraded, or at least needed another grandstand to double the crowd size so that they could be a big-time team. NYU at their best in the 1920s and 30s could draw between 10,000 and 20,000, and if they upgraded facilities, they might be able to house 30 to 40,000 at least, but I don't know if they could actually draw that many at the time, as they were only drawing big-time numbers when they played big-time teams, like versus Fordham, as they could draw over 50,000, but otherwise they only had big-time crowds versus Georgia and Colgate, as they drew over 30,000 there, and their games at the Polo Grounds weren't drawing well either, as they had more than 15,000, and they were lucky to draw that when they did. But probably the biggest reason, and probably the biggest reason for this program going away, is that they really could never get over the hump and go undefeated and or go to a bowl game. Their best chance for a bowl game was in 1935 when they won their first seven games before losing to Fordham in their last game. Over the 80 years of playing college football, NYU won 199 games, they lost 226 games, and they had 30 ties. Their final points came in their seventh game in the 1952 season versus Rutgers, in the second quarter on that interception return for a touchdown by Bob Moot. That's why I said to remember that. But even though the school never won a bowl game or never went to a bowl game, they did give college football the biggest and best prize in the Heisman Trophy, with the model and sculptor coming from NYU. So I hope you learned a little about this classic college football program that really wasn't given a chance, but has some really cool history behind it. So I hope you really liked that video. Make sure you like it. Make sure you share this video. And of course, make sure you subscribe to the channel, please. Also, make sure you ring the bell so you get all those updates on when I drop a new video. I'm going to be dropping a new discontinued video next week on the University of Chicago and their football team, which wasn't discontinued, it was just diminished. And I'll talk about that coming up next week. But again, thank you so much, and make sure you subscribe to the channel, please. Follow me on Twitter, @SportsWrong, and have a fantastic day.